Good. So this was the end of yesterday, I think. And today, I mean, I would not call it exactly a lecture. It will be a sort of general talk, informative discussion, where I will try to summarize more or less the state of the art. Maybe this summary could be a bit biased by personal conviction, but okay, it is. Maybe it's not a super objective, or maybe yes, it depends. Future will tell. So first of all, I said, okay, the UB approach, we tried to go through all the details. For the moment, I was not discussing the case of spinning black holes. So, but this is what I will try to do today, quickly. On the one hand, we will discuss what you have to do when you have spin, and what is done, what are the results, let's say. And also, what can you do when you have tidal interactions? So objects that are not black holes, point particles, let's say, but neutron stars, endowed with a certain structure, so matter, and this structure can evidently influence the gravitational interaction and the gravitational wave emission. I have to go back. The slides were, this is a general thing, but everything is here. And I want to go back first to tell you the motivation of all this, no? And the motivation is essentially here, no? Here there was the gravitational wave detection first. And this is the signal that was seen in September 2015. And in fact, this signal was seen without doing any adaptive filtering. In a sense that in this case, the signal to noise ratio was so large that it was enough to apply to the output of the detector a general filtering when you remove higher frequencies and lower frequencies, and you were able to see this and realize that there was something in the data. This something was real, it was not an injection, because something that is done to test all the data analysis procedure is to inject an analytical, a numerical signal in the detector noise. Somebody does this, and then all the others have to look for if there is something or not. So, and it was clear at the end of the day that the screen died. At the end of the day, that this was something real and not Okay, doesn't matter. Yes, and not the human artifact. Okay, doesn't matter. But this was a very particular case and absolutely unexpected, because you were not expecting just switching on the detector. You would have seen something immediately, just 3 days after that everything was locked together and working, because this is what happened, and it is remarkable. Also remarkable the fact that when this happened, the detectors were not yet in the science run. It were in what is called the engineering mode, in the sense that everything is set, everything is working, but you are, let's say, still waiting for the initial official thing. So it was absolutely remarkable. So this is what was seen. But then the problem is, what have you seen? And in order to say what have you seen, you really need to have a good theoretical description. I mean, this is something that I said at the beginning, but now that we have sort of passed through all the steps that allow you to compute an analytical waveform, then I will discuss also the numerical stuff, but let's say we are analytical, you understand why. I mean, because the reason is this, no? That you have a certain degeneracy between the waveforms, because what I try to say is that, okay, you have what are the parameters in the game? The parameter is the symmetric mass ratio and then the spins. I have not talked yet of the spins, but we will see it in a moment. What is the symmetric mass ratio doing? The symmetric mass ratio doing is, in a sense, making it a longer or shorter waveform, starting from the same initial frequency, and and there are small details that change around the merger or the late phasing that you need to understand the model in detail in order to be sure that the masses are the ones that were measured, that the spins are zero, so on and so forth, because there is a degeneracy also between the effect of the spins and the effect of the mass ratio. And all what you see, especially if you look just at the 2-2 mode, so the leading order mode, is a waveform that, okay, maybe the frequency in one case is here, in the other case rises a little bit faster, in the other case it is a little bit down, and yeah, I mean, since you don't know where the thing is actually starting, you can always adapt things in order to make to cancel this effect if things are not modeled properly. And in fact, also the detector noise is playing a relevant role, because if detector noise is very small, I mean, or in other terms, the signal-to-noise ratio is large, you are able to see these differences. Otherwise, everything is all the same. But I mean, in the future, the signal-to-noise ratio will increase, so a priori one wants to have a very precise understanding of all the details. And the way you do the measurement, eventually, is the following. I mean, you do a correlation between the output of the detector, the Fourier transform of your template, weighted on the detector noise. So this is the match filtering technique that is used. I mean, it is used for the first case. It was not needed. I mean, in the sense that you could see it immediately, almost immediately. But in general, when you have smaller signal to noise ratios, the signal is just hidden in the noise, and you have to extract it by this kind of correlation. So this is why you need a bank of templates for all the possible things, in a sense, changing the mass ratio, or if you wish, the masses of the two binaries, and the spins. In general, the spins can be whatever, it's not just aligned things. So this means that you need, and you have to do this for many, 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 many cycles, because let's put it this way. I mean, this is the kind of waveform you want. But in fact, what happens is that the detector is this. The detector noise looks like this, and you need something that starts at from 10 hertz and gets up to 1 kilohertz or more, which means a lot of cycles. I mean, the number of cycles evidently depend on the kind of the total mass, the number of cycles to which you are sensitive, because the same kind of waveform, this is the waveform here is written in, let's say, geometric units, in the sense that everything is scaled by the total mass. But what happens? If you have an object that is a higher mass, the same waveform does not depend on things, moves on the window where the detector is sensitive, so that if you have a high mass object, let's say like the ones that were found, the total mass was 65 solar mass. You have the merger that was around 130 hertz. If you have objects that are lighter, you are more and more sensitive to the in spiral part. And you need to compute a template very accurate. You need to compute a lot of cycles, so many, many, many orbits. And if you want to do this just numerically, this means this amounts in a huge computational cost, because doing numerical relativity, I mean, this was the what I was saying at the beginning, the old idea, no? Said, okay, we cannot do anything analytically. We have to do that just numerically. We have to solve Einstein equation numerically. Solving Einstein equation numerically is extremely complicated. And it took several years to get there. Now, there is, I mean, this is an example. This was the first catalog of numerical relativity waveform, very long numerical relativity waveform that existed, but this is just 150, and many of them are processing and, in a sense, almost useless for tuning the numerical simulations. But now there are, recently they released another 100 numerical waveforms, so that you go to this catalog, eventually you have 300 numerical waveforms. I mean, the longest are 40 or 30 orbits or whatever. I mean, it's not many cycles, but I mean, it is a lot if you think that it is a numerical simulation, and a numerical simulation that took months to be completed. First, you have to develop the code, which is far from trivial. Then you have to run the thing, then you have to analyze the data, and then eventually you have something, but it's just one thing. So you have 300 waveform, let's say, but in this case, you needed 250,000 templates, and then when you have to do the analysis stuff, you have to evaluate these things a lot of times. So there is a huge computational cost behind. So that's what the reason why one wants to have analytical representation of these things. So it's just an introduction to allow you to understand better what is going on. And evidently, you can do several things. So first you said, okay, I have a lot of numerical waveforms. I can interpolate among them in some form. Good. But unfortunately, all these numerical waveforms don't go up to the very early phase. The other thing is that, okay, but in the early phase, I have the post-Newtonian theory. So I can compute the waveform with post-Newtonian theory, and then I can match it to the numerical simulation. Again, very good idea. But unfortunately, as we saw, post-Newtonian theory is very unstable. You don't know, when you go to very low frequencies, in fact, you don't know where the post-Newtonian approximation will break down. Because I mean, there is a lot of literature discussing this, and unfortunately, it is also a lot of useless literature in part, because since it was for some time, it was there was a certain conservatism in the community, and the paradigm was okay, post-Newtonian theory. This is what we have to use, because and then they start comparing. The outcome, I mean, post-Newtonian theory is when you compute waveform templates, let's say, you always take something like the energy in PN divided by the flux of angular momentum, the F of the X, and I don't remember the formula, but let's say from this you can get the phase. Now, you understand that if this is given by the Taylor expansion, if this is given by a Taylor expansion, I can expand things in several different ways. And when you look at the literature, you will find that there are several, many post-Newtonian approximants that give you different formulas for the phase as a function of time or the phase as a function of frequency. Because one decided it is a good idea of expanding in one form, the other is a good idea of expanding in a different form, and each post-Newtonian approximant gives you a different result. And then there is a discrete amount of part of literature saying, ah, yes, this is good, this is bad, but then if I change this, this is good, then I add spins, so what was good before is bad, so it's a completely crazy stuff that actually occupies a lot of paper. This is a very interesting sociological thing, because this kind of game restarted after the numerical relativity simulation were completed in 2005, say, now we have the exact solution, so let's go back to post-Newtonian, analyze the post-Newtonian thing. That is something relatively simple that people can understand. But unfortunately, if you go back to all this, those Damur, Iyer and Satya Prakash paper from 1998, let's say, to 2000, at the time where the EOB did not exist yet, say, they had already done all this kind of analysis, saying, we use Padé approximant, we use a different representation of the flux that is more robust, and so on and so forth, and we do comparison with different Taylor approximants. And we concluded that the Taylor approximants are not robust, so we try to use something else. And then, on the other side of the ocean, the thing was, let's take again all the Taylor approximants and do comparison with numerical relativity, and we see that, evidently, things are not robust, but for just by chance, there are some that are better than others. So it is a completely, I mean, this was really noise that occupied the thing for years, but that's the way it is. But I wanted to stress this. And in fact, for example, you can see this very well in this plot. So this is the longest numerical simulation so far. So this is a binary black hole simulation of a two black holes non-spinning. The mass ratio is 7, so one much larger than the other. And it is how many? 350 gravitational waves, so means 170 orbits. And the beginning, there is a pointer here, right? No, it used to have. Yes. There is an old style pointer. Now, what is this? This is, let's say, an analytical representation of the detector noise. And this is in the frequency domain, so this is the Fourier transform of the signal. So you take the waveform, you compute the Fourier transform, and I think you get this kind of stuff here. This is the amplitude. So, and this is 10 Hz. So let's say here the noise of the detector is too large. And the choice of the simulation was, okay, let's start from the very beginning and have a complete thing. This took months of being accomplished. I mean, it's a remarkable result from the technical point of view. And also, actually, it was so difficult that it is not even done with a single simulation. Because to do this kind of simulation, you have to put the two black holes very far apart. You are solving Einstein equation on a grid. So a grid means that at the moment you have to put boundary conditions here in order to solve it. So the black holes were very far apart, the grid was very far, and these things start moving, initially very slowly and then progressively. But at the moment, the boundaries, I mean, when you solve a PDEs on a finite grid, you are always afraid of what the boundaries do. So you have to put the proper boundary condition. If you don't put the correct boundary condition, for example, something that either is dumping the things at the boundary, you may have reflection, or you may have that the boundaries are physically, that the boundaries that are fake because you are solving a system on a supercomputer are actually doing something physically on your system. So this is what you have to control. In fact, what happened here is that since this thing was so big, after a while you could see a drift of the center of mass. So they had to stop the simulation at a certain point, that I think maybe it is here, and then restart it on a different grid setup with a shorter, with a different grid, in order to avoid this spurious drift of center of mass to destroy completely the simulation. So the longest numerical simulation available is made by patching together two things. Anyway, you get this, and then you compute what is called the unfaithfulness. The unfaithfulness is, did I write it somewhere? Yes, I apologize because to compute all this, to do these lectures, I did a patchwork of several things. But let's say the unfaithfulness is the scalar product between the exact between the two things mediated with the noise of the detector. I will in the frequency domain. Let's say you do a product between the two waveforms, and you subtract one. Let's say if the unfaithfulness is zero, you are saying that the two waveforms are one equal to the other. If it is not, it is larger. So, and then here they did the kind of game that I was saying. So this Taylor T4 is one possible post-Newtonian approximant that exists. Taylor T1 is one. So these are two different ways of doing the same thing. But this is just for the inspiral, in fact. So all these two things, since are based on post-Newtonian expansion, they don't have the merger. So at the moment they fail. I don't think I have the full unfaithfulness for the other thing. But you see that, let's say, this is the numerical error. The effective one body is here, pure in spiral. Okay, and it will include also the merger. And the effective one body calibrated to numerical relativity, it is here. So all these ambiguities just disappear. These are phenomenological models that also are found in the literature, and in fact are nowadays the only alternative in quotes, let's say, using the UOB because of the full waveform computed by the UOB approach. Although they, okay, I will explain. And it is this idea of saying I have some part that is Taylor, and then I attach it somewhere to a numerical simulation, okay? But the problem is, where is this somewhere when I attach two things? Because this will fail at some stage, and this other one will fail early on. I mean, you do this patching, and then you do this for several numerical simulations, and then you do an interpolation. But what was done at the time, indeed, was using post-Newtonian, and they are bad already in the inspiral. And this is the effect of the fit and the effect of the instability of the post-Newtonian approximants. What is actually done now, although should be improved, I mean, after a while, people convince themselves that the effective one body also give you a more robust description of the inspiral, because it is resummed also there. You have more information there. So instead of solving the Hamiltonian equation, the post-Newtonian equation, you can just use the UOB without numerical calibration as is, gives you a prediction. It will maybe fail or not be so accurate just for a few cycles around the merger, but all the rest are fine. And okay, that's what is what it is done now. But okay, this was just to give you an idea that evidently numerical simulation is important, but I see it important just as a tool to extract information from to include in the analytical model and eventually to check what you are doing. And to do this, you don't need to do thousands of numerical simulations, but you need to do only the numerical simulations that are more difficult or most difficult. Which means, for example, okay, now I will start discussing the spin, but let's say the ones where the spins are aligned and high are more relevant than simulations where the spins are one up and the other one down, because this will, in a sense, cancel, and the result of the dynamics here, and you can see this in the UOB approach clearly, although I'm not sure that I'm able to do it today, this is almost equivalent to something where there is no spin. But for example, this is really remarkable. that in this catalog, okay, so there was this idea of say, okay, we just cover densely the parameter space with all the possible orientations. And here, this catalog that was the first that was released, the spins orientation in some situation where you see that there is a precession and all that, were just chosen randomly. For me, this is a mystery. There were spins chosen randomly. Okay. So, the kind of information that you can extract from one simulation, I mean, is maybe redundant with what you have in the other, or, okay, it's nice to hit a word. In some situation, it is useful, however. And now, no, it's just conformally flat. I'm not sure that I'm able to understand the question, nor that I am able to answer, but what they do actually, I mean, at the beginning, they solve the constraints. But so you mean the choice of coordinates? Yes. Yes. Okay. This is a spectral code, so it's done in a different way. But yes, you have to choose coordinates in some form. But I don't think that they do that. I don't know. I mean, they choose what they want and what they wish. Ah, yeah. You mean yes? I mean, you mean the fact that what was that? That you can be close to ADM coordinates in this sense. I'm unable to answer. But anyway, at the end, you have a waveform. The waveform is gauge invariant, and you forget of all the rest. Okay. No, I mean, this has to be, I think, is an important point that has to be taken into account. But now, let's say that one is converging there, thanks to also to interaction between Alessandra and the Caltech-Cornell group. So it is clear that for tuning or completing the analytical model, you need things of this kind, and then maybe the spin precession can be numerical waveform with spin precession that are more complicated are used as a check, let's say, of what you are doing. Okay, but now what should I talk about? So let's say this was a general thing. We can briefly sketch what is done in our approach for the spin that might be useful to understand. And we move to the numerical thing. Okay? So, this is maybe getting a bit technical, but it's part of the informative thing, because in fact I mean spin is important, although for the first detection, I mean the first detection you had no indication that the two black holes were spinning. For the second one, that was at a very long waveforming spiral, there is some indication that at least one of the two objects is spinning, but the spin is also small. Anyway, the idea when you have the spin is that, at least, there are now two proposals again. So what is used for gravitational wave data analysis in LIGO? And this thing that is currently not used and not part of the LIGO library, but hopefully through Virgo will be there soon. So the idea is that in the Schwarzschild case, you have this UB description where the Hamiltonian is a deformation of the yields, a deformation of the dynamics of a particle on Schwarzschild. On the other hand, when you are in the spinning case, you have the Hamiltonian of Kerr, and you treat the system like if you had a sort of deformed spinning particle moving on a deformed Kerr black hole. Although, let's say this is a way of seeing this, but maybe it's just a good idea to look at the Hamiltonian, how it looks like. And did I write it explicitly? Yes, maybe it is here. The UB Hamiltonian with the usual structure with the first square root is always the same. Then you have here the effective Hamiltonian. Let's just look at this part. So here you have, let's define a bit of notations. Don't be scared. It's simpler than what you may look looking at this equation. So it's just a matter of defining things properly. So chi1 or chi1 2 is the spin, the dimensionless quantity, divided by the mass of the black hole square. So this is a dimensionless quantity that tells you how fast is the black hole spinning. So that if chi equal 1, this is an extremal black hole, it is the most difficult case. Good. Then this part here takes into account the spin orbit coupling, and this is a sort of orbital part. So let's look first at the spin orbit thing. It is convenient and useful to write things in this form with these effective spin variables. So one is given by the sum of S1 plus S2, so chi1 is okay, sorry, this also I forgot to mention, it's just chi1 is, x1 is m1 over the total mass, and the E2, 1, 2 is this, 1, 2. Now, what you find actually, and this is another weighted combination of the sum of the two-dimensionized spin. What happens actually is the following. So L is the orbital angular momentum, and the idea of constructing things in this form is that when you go in the test particle limit, and the particle is non-spinning, this Hamiltonian becomes the Hamiltonian of a test particle on Kerr. I mean, you can write the Hamiltonian of the test particle on Kerr in this form, where here you have the spin orbit coupling, so this becomes a 2 divided R cube term that you can find in the Kerr Hamiltonian. And on the contrary, if the particle is spinning, here you will have the spin orbit coupling between the spin of the particle and the angular momentum, the orbital angular momentum of the black hole. When, in fact, you move away from the spin orbit coupling, from the test particle limit, what happens is that terms that depend on the symmetric mass ratio start here and here, in what are, we call them gyrogravitomagnetic ratios or gyrogravitomagnetic functions all together. Okay, so there is the structure. And then what is the spin orbit coupling doing? The spin orbit coupling doing is, this was a result already of 2001 was found by Thibault at the time with a different representation of the spin orbit and spin-spin interaction. What happens is that if you are in this situation where the two spins are aligned with the angular momentum, with the orbital angular momentum, the interaction is repulsive, is like the other thing, so you can plunge and keeping spiraling, spiraling. You never plunge. You in spiral, keeping spiraling when up to very high frequency at smaller distances. And in a sense, this is the most difficult situation because to represent, because you evident. I mean, what I had not said that behind all this there is post-Newtonian theory. So that post-Newtonian theory allows you to compute the spin orbit and spin correction to the standard EDM Hamiltonian at high order, let's say 3.5 pn, and then on this Hamiltonian, yeah, maybe I can set that. So let's say that I have an HEDM that is an orbital part plus a spin orbit and a spin. This is in spn thing. Then I said yesterday, okay, the UB is built like a mapping between two sets of energy level, but behind this there is a canonical transformation. So you start from this, you apply the canonical transformation, and you get the H-effective UB that appears there. And this H-effective UB has this kind of structure with the gyrogravitomagnetic functions, the spin-orbit coupling, etc. But there are still some residual post-Newtonian expansion somewhere. And these residual post-Newtonian expansions, maybe I wrote them here, yes. These residual post-Newtonian expansions, in fact, are these functions here. Because you have done this canonical transformation, you are now in the good coordinate system, but something that is perturbative, let's say, is still there. And in fact, you get these things, you write them properly in a certain gauge, because there is also the choice of gauge here. The choice of spin gauge basically means choosing the triad with respect to which you decompose your spin vector. But okay, this is a sort of detail, but let's say you want to choose the gauge where things look simpler if possible. And in particular, yeah, maybe this is the thing where, yes, for example, this is, in general, these functions here depend on the angular momentum, the radial momentum, and the radial separation, which is 1 over r. Yes, what I wrote here explicitly is how this function looks for a Kerr black hole. Okay. For here we are in the non-precessing case, you put theta equal pi halves, all this disappears, you have just 2. Anyway, the point is that these are functions that remain from post-Newtonian calculation that are given as an expansion in 1 over r, you see, and terms that depend on the radial momentum, n time p. Okay, n is in this case is the versor or the relative separation. And so this is the first time you see 1 over c squared, 1 over c4. Again, this is given as a post-Newtonian expansion. And this is where is the problem now. In the sense that you have your usual post-Newtonian thing, but, I mean, your usual UB Hamiltonian, but these things, when are given in this post-Newtonian expanded form, are, I don't remember if they are too big or too much, but let's say they are too big, or then you clearly see they are unstable when you increase the post-Newtonian order. Analogously to what we were seeing yesterday, no? That with the A function, that up to 2 pn is like that, and then at 3 pn it becomes larger, and you have to act again on this post-Newtonian expansion in order to make it better behaved. And in fact, this is eventually what it is done here. And yes, I think the point was that these things were too big, and they were resummed by sort of taking a sort of inverse in order to make them smaller and better behaved. This was again a choice that was done to build this model. It is among the choices that you have to do when you do research in that sense. No, you know, you identify where the problem is, and then you try to find a way to bend the thing to your will. And this is what happened here. But it is by no means the only way to do this. And in fact, if you take this particular summation, these functions are better behaved. But in some situation, maybe they behave too well. They become immediately too polite. And when you do comparison with numeric relativity simulation, you realize that in this form there is something that is missing. Exactly like in this case, there was something that is missing. So one solution here was to again add an effective parameter that is doing what? It is just telling you whether your spin orbit coupling is a little bit stronger or a little bit weaker. Because in fact, what I forgot in my completely random way of doing this, what maybe I forgot to stress again is this thing that if the spin orbit coupling, if the spins are aligned, the spin orbit coupling makes things repulsive, which means that if in the non-spinning case your merger is here, when you start spinning, you get to higher frequencies. You can understand this easily looking at what happens for the motion of a point particle on Kerr. And similarly, if the spins are anti-aligned, the things becomes more attractive and you plunge earlier, so to lower frequencies. And in fact, what happens to the signal? This is interesting. This is the spin orbit coupling, and in fact was clearly understood and discussed already in 2001 in the paper of Thibault when he introduced the first EOB approach with spin. Then when numerical relativity arrived, let's say 2005, 2006, and started solving this problem exactly, because I mean, this is really part of the Hamiltonian. So when he did his calculation, said, okay, there is this thing, and this should make, because of how the energy is done, because the EOB was resummed, so it could really do prediction on the location of this of the last stable orbit, because this happens because in one case the last stable orbit that is this is what I forgot in to say let's say we have H effective that has an orbital part plus a spin orbit thing. In first approximation, this orbital part is the same orbital part that we saw yesterday. And then there is the spin orbit. The effective potential now is not anymore just due to this part, okay? So 1 plus P phi square over R square times A, the A function with the new dependent correction. But there is also another terms that come from the spin orbit that acts on this potential. So that if the spins are aligned, in fact, this goes inside, and the last state that would be, let's say, when you go to the inflection point, you are here, because of the compensation between these two terms that can be plus or minus, in fact, because there is L times S, so in one case it is minus, in one case it's plus, if they are up or down. In one case it moves inside, so that's why you keep plunging, keeping spiraling and the plunge is delayed, while in the other case you are here. So doing this kind of considerations on the very early version of the EOB that was, of the spinning EOB that was at low post-Newtonian order and all that, but you could already see what was the physics there, what were the main physical effects coming there. He said, okay, this is what is there, and you will go to smaller, in fact, this is the other important thing, you will go to smaller distances, and then you will emit more energy. So the signal emitted by spinning black hole with spin aligned will be stronger than the non-spinning case. This was all predicted in the 2001 paper where he thanks David Blair for having given him the idea of doing the spin. And then numerical relativity in 2005-2006 solved the problem and found exactly this, that now is everywhere. Although the difference is that they call it the hang-up effect, in the sense that they attach together and then they keep spiraling. And then how does the waveform look like? Because here I don't have plots, so I have to draw things a little bit. So let's say this is the normal situation. The non-spinning situation. You have something that looks like this. Good. If the spins are down, you don't have to time. You don't do so many cycles. So that, for example, you are okay. You arrive here. You have a merger, and then things dump very much faster. I think this is related to the fact that you have a lower final angular momentum, so the frequency of the modes are different and the damping time is larger. On the contrary, if you are spinning very fast, you have a lot more cycle during the merger, so you keep spiraling, you never plunge. I mean, you plunge much slower. Okay, this was the description. I was saying this. Ah, yes. And the point is the following, that, I mean, evidently, there are. I'm focusing on the spin orbit coupling because it's the simplest thing to understand here, and it is the main effect. But you have also spin-spin coupling that, now I will say, they are always repulsive. But the point is that if you add the parameter here, you can modify the spin orbit coupling in order to your will, let's say. Evidently, it is something that you would like not to do. But again, look at the choices that you did. There are several choices. So we start from something that is here, that is better, that is not. That is a post-Newtonian expansion, then you resum it in the first way you can think about. It is very large. I take the inverse so that it is small. It becomes polite. But then, as I said, it's too polite, and you add a little bit of roughness in order to make him a little bit more rusty. And in fact, if you do this, you have enough flexibility to be able to match in a very simple way, because there is just one parameter that you can tune, and I will show you how, any numerical simulation that was present at the time, but the dependence is simple. Again, I stress, this is among the choices that you do in your scientific life in order to get easily to a result and having something that works. But this is part of current research. And it's not, it's certainly not the solution, and maybe not the best thing to do. In fact, what I want to stress here, there is just a parameter that acts that eventually will come out as to be spin dependent. So it's not exactly spin orbit coupling; it's something in between. The group of Alessandra has a different structure of the Hamiltonian, and in fact they end up having a parameter for that you use for the spin orbit things, an effective spin orbit coupling, and an effective spin-spin coupling. So they have to tune two things, that is more complicated and a bit less elegant. And in fact what was done here with the numerical simulation that were available. Ah, well, look, there is really a typo. Yes. For the numerical simulation that were at the time, this is the behavior of these parameters, this parameter versus chi. So chi in this case is just I mean, this is the equal mass equal spin, so chi is chi 1 plus chi 2. And so this is a work of 2014, and you see that, I mean, how do you do the tuning? Evidently, you have some, the numerical simulation have some error, and you do a comparisons, and you want to tune this parameter in order to be compatible with the error. You don't want to overtune things, I mean. Actually, the flexibility is such that you could have the phase difference that is plotted here flat from the beginning to the end. But this is asking too much, okay? You have to be objective and say, okay, there are errors there. I don't want to be precisely on top of the numerical simulation. And it was absurdly easy to find that this parameter was just a straight line versus chi. So absurdly easy that this model was built starting from the non-spinning case in January of 2014. And the story is the following. During the, I think, the Christmas break of 2013, Thibault went back to rethinking to the way of doing the spin-orbit coupling and a different way of incorporating the spin-spin interaction in the black holes, in particularly writing the Kerr-Hamiltonian as a very simple deformation of the Schwarzschild one, in the sense that you can write there is this paper of 2014 that I think the first part is very informative because it allows you to it shows that you can write the Kerr-Hamiltonian that usually the Hamiltonian of a particle on a Kerr metric that is usually very complicated, actually in a very simple form where you see that there are functions that are nothing more than deformation of the same A function of Schwarzschild. And so you see there are two pieces basically. You replace the Schwarzschild radius with a centrifugal radius that is this piece, and then you dress the Schwarzschild metric with this thing that takes into account the quadrupolar deformation due to the rotation. I mean, in a resum form. And in fact, in doing this, your Kerr, the Hamiltonian of a particle on Kerr becomes very simple. It's 1 second doing that. I mean, I think that here it was rediscovered because discussing with Donato Bini, I realized that long ago, also, I mean, it is something that is somehow known, but was never put exactly in this form. I mean, just because Donato was telling me that in some old work of De Felice, the same kind of thing was appearing, but it was in De Felice language, so it was another thing. But let's say, this was very, very simple, and the idea was to say, okay, this is what happens with Kerr. In the effective one body, I have the A function, I have the same kind of structure, so I replace, if you wish, this thing by the A function resummed in this form, I mean with the new dependent correction, and this A, that is the Kerr parameter, is a combination of the spins, so chi1 plus x2 chi2, maybe modulo m square somewhere that always forget. And in fact, the story is funny also, although nobody knows, and in fact, it is me against the rest of me, I mean, our two. So I said that during the Christmas Eve, it was this. Then in January, I went back to IHS for 3 weeks because my wife was about to give birth, so I was, and the baby was predicted for Mars, so okay, you can go there, then you remain here, and nothing more. So in 2 weeks, actually, we work on this, and we implemented like crazy some different possible representation of this gravitomagnetic coefficient. So first we started with some very complicated expression that were depending on the gauges. It was absolutely a mess, and then I told him, no, we'll never succeed, this is too complicated, let's go to the Damour DJS, Damour Yanovsky Schaeffer gauge, well, the angular momentum disappears and you just have simple simple expression that are function of U and the PR star. This is again one choice. Also here, actually, what you have here, it appears the spin orbit coupling of the test particle, the spinning test particle, but this is actually known exactly in closed form. Here, for historical reason, exactly because I was rushing, so we just had 2 weeks to do that, it is given in Taylor expanded form. We start exploring also what is going on if you use the full thing, but let's say, for the moment, this is working well. And at the time, there were not many, but less than now, numerical relativity simulation available, and once that you plug this in the model, it was absolutely super easy to get this. So easy that for a few months I said, "I don't believe. Do we believe what we are doing or not? Is there something that we are missing? Do we like this? Because from the theoretical point of view, you don't like this, since you." There is a parameter, but the value of this parameter is depending on the spin. So you are putting something in the spin orbit coupling that depends on the spin. You don't like this very much. But the reason is that is related to the choice of gauge. You have removed the angular momentum, and in a sense, there is a price that you have to pay. So this remained like that. My daughter was born, the thing was there for a while, then we finally decided to publish this with just the equal mass case, and then we kept going, and we realized that the same kind of structure, very simple structure, occurs also when you move for to other mass ratio and other spins, but were really a very limited amount of simulation at the time. With the parameter that, in fact, it was fitted by something like that. This, actually, this is a rather old transparency. There is something more, a little bit more involved. But this function is not so complicated. Actually, this is just a linear function in the spin, the sum of the spins, and in the difference of the spin. And it's such that this is the equal mass part, and then is the here is what. You have moving from away from the unequal mass part. The other direction. What I want to say is this, just to give you an idea of what of the boring work. So you have numerical simulation. All these things are, so this is the symmetric mass ratio, and these are the spins. So as I said, these are the most difficult high spins that are actually look very simple in this. But most of them were equal mass. When you move away from the equal mass case, what was available in 2014 were just one case where Q equal 2. Ah, yes, this is really an old table. This was when I was writing the paper, so I took it that was unfinished. One case were equal 2, and five mass rations for Q equal 3. You see spin minus 0.5, plus 0.5, plus 0.5 attack. One Q equal 4. So you expect the model that you tune that it will be very accurate in this region and probably will fail here. Will fail or might not be so accurate here. So 3 months ago, so 3 months, no, 3 weeks ago, so now you have to believe me over what I'm saying because nothing is published. 3 months ago, 3 months ago, again, 3 weeks ago, finally the Caltech-Cornell simulation, after that they have completed a new version of the UBNR model that will be used by LIGO in the next runs. Finally, so the paper is out, they released another about 100 numerical simulations that are in this region from mass ratio 2 to mass ratio 3, let's say. So not extremely, but with several spins. So spins of different magnitudes up to, let's say, plus or minus 0.85. And so I could check whether what I was doing at the time was correct or not. Well, I was surprised, in fact, to find that for mass ratio Q equal 3 and plus 0.85, let's say plus plus 0.85 or minus minus 0.85, incredibly, the difference is negligible. I mean, you see that there is some glitch or some slightly dirty thing around the merger, but here is okay, essentially okay. And I think it's remarkable even because I was just starting with a very reduced amount of simulation. On the contrary, so here I get phase difference that are well within the error bar. On the contrary, for Q equal 2, where I was actually not relying on anything, I had no dependence on spin, there I have a problem. I mean, I have a problem in the sense that the in-spiral, my in-spiral is a bit too short or too long. But on the contrary, the representation of the merger that was induced by here is okay. So this, for me, was a useful lesson because it tells me that this is really current work, redoing the calibration, but it is an exaggerated thing. Just taking two waveforms for Q equal 2, fixing the parameters and doing an interpolation, probably the model will work perfectly for all the 94 simulations that they have released now. And this simulation, I mean, is in the usual spirit that they do. So I have 0.6, 0.4, 0.6, 0.2, and so on and so forth. But in fact, what is important here is to look at the spin-orbit coupling. And the spin-orbit coupling is not this. It's a combination of the spins and the mass ratio, these S and S star things. Yes, also, if ever it happens to you to look at, to listen to some talks or whatever, again, I stress, what is not important is not the mass ratio, M1 over M2, but rather, as I said, the symmetric mass ratio. So that data set with Q equals 7, 8, or, I think this is really interesting from the sociological point of view. Because when you look at the catalog, you will see simulation Q equals 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5, 9, but this is not the unit. This is not the parameter of the of the binary black holes. It is nu. And nu is Q divided 1 plus Q square. The difference between this and this is the same. You have eaten the world for nothing. Okay. But it is incredible, I think. Also because this is well known around, but evidently this is 9, okay, 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5, 2, 2.5, okay, good. If you have a lot of money, you can do this, and you don't care. My idea is that, okay, numerical simulations are extremely important, but let's do the good ones. Anyway, I can mention this. I want to mention this. Yes, so first, this is the unfaithfulness, so the kind of thing that that he used to, and you can find in the literature to stress how good the model is. So you take the Fourier transform, because this is the quantity that in fact is used for to analyze the data. I mean, let's say this is the scalar product between two waveforms. But in reality, you do this, it is the scalar product between the real signal that comes, that is in the universe, and your template weighted on the noise. And the typical target that you want to get is 1%. Actually, the philosophy around is a bit different, because from the pragmatical point of view, you say, okay, and this is what is done for LIGO, it is said, okay, I have a model that depends on some parameters, and I determine these parameters using a grand fit by looking at this observable, and then I tune these parameters by in some form until I get the limit of 1%. What I think is that actually the UB is, if you at least follow this kind of procedure with all the limitation that I was saying, so all the choices that one has to do step by step that are by no means the maybe not the best ones, or you want to work more theoretically on that, is that, I mean, the UB can do more. And in fact, this is what our model can do. And in fact, this was a check done a posteriori on the same data sets that is done here. Actually, this is now being redone with some changes in the model, because maybe here I was too optimistic and I was using sort of best representation that I could get of the waveform, while the post-merger could be a little bit worse. Anyway, what I want to stress is this is what is used for data analysis, and in fact this is what is behind the these plots that you can find if you by chance had looked at the PRL paper of the detection and parameter estimation for the sources. This is what is used. So there is this model now. This is SUBNR V2, but actually now there is SUBNR OBNR V3, that is a precessing model. Okay, that takes this thing that uses a different Hamiltonian, as I said, this uses a different Hamiltonian, and then they tune spin orbit and spin coupling in order to be consistent with this huge set of numerical simulations. So there is the V3 that is a precessing thing. Precessing is very, it's complicated, and it is something that I have not done, because if you have the spins that are not aligned, what happens? It happens that the plane of the orbit is moving, and then they can plunge. The fact that the plane of the orbit is moving means that, first, due to this gauge effect, again, the fact that you are not in this plane, but you are an observer here, you see that higher modes are excited more, let's say, are excited at the same level. Okay, let me open a parenthesis here. Yes. Maybe I will do 2 hours, actually. No, wait a second. When did I start? At 9? A quarter past. Let me just finish this, then we can stop 5 minutes. Yes. No, yes, no, let's stop now, because it will take more than... stop 5 minutes. Okay, let me... the last effort. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. 2 people are missing. let's go back to the informative thing. So what I wanted to say is that for the test particle, or for the normal situation, yes, let me give you this. When you have spin aligned or no spin and all that, there is a clear hierarchy between the multiples. So let's say if we look at the merger, so this is the 2-2, the 2-1, let me tell you in general. So the structure, the multipolar structure of the waveform depends on the geometric property of the thing. So if, exactly, one was missing, correct? And there is maybe still one. Okay. Yeah, correct. Look at that over here. Yes. Consistent. Yes. So the fact that some multiples are switched on or off depends on the geometry, in the sense the mass ratio and the structure of the spin. And you understand what happens just looking at the post-Newtonian expansion, because, as I said, let's say the 2-2 mold is proportional to nu. When you go to 1, it is proportional to 1 minus 4 nu. H33, I think, again, should be nu, 1 minus 4 nu, etc. Here I'm not sure. Maybe, okay, I don't remember, but I just remember the first two. Anyway, each multiple has here a function of the symmetric mass ratio. And this is particularly telling you that if you have an equal mass binary, the H21 will disappear, as well as other multiples. All the multiples that have M odd will disappear, and some other will remain. And so that while the maximum excitation of the let's say odd or subdominant multiples is there where you have the where nu is equal to zero. So this is what I was saying at the beginning. So that if you have a equal mass case, most symmetric case, you're circular and everything is simple. If you have a test particle, you are much less symmetric and you have all the higher things. So that also in this respect, with this idea in mind, if you have an equal mass, no spinning binary, it is perfectly symmetric, you don't have emission of linear momentum, while if you see it in a certain form where you have a test particle that's displunging, you have the maximum emission of linear momentum once that you have scaled things by the proper leading order factor. Similar hierarchy, so let's take a general mass ratio, so that Q equal 3. Q equal 3, which means nu equal 3 over 16. Okay? This is a good intermediate situation where you can have good excitation of the subdominant multiples. And in this case, you can have the 2-2 is here, the 2-1 is much smaller already. The 3-3 is at the same order of the 2-1, more or less. Ah, no, you see, there was one more. So it was 20 modulo Luca Lusanna. And so on and so forth. And in fact, what is why there is this hierarchy? The hierarchy is there because the higher multiples enter at higher post-Newtonian order. This is what we saw at the very beginning. When I said, let's compute the mass quadruple, the current quadruple and the mass octuple. The mass quadruple was Newtonian. The current quadruple was post-Newtonian. It has 1 over c square. And the other one, the mass octuple, was again 1 over c square. So they are 1PN correction for the modes 2-1 and 3-3. That's why they are more or less of the same order. When you go to higher order, evidently, you will get higher post-Newtonian corrections here. And with the same velocity, since each of these things is proportional to a power of the velocity, they will be progressively suppressed. And again, it's another way, you know, of saying that when you put the flux together, the higher multiples enter at higher post-Newtonian order, and so on. But this is the situation for spin aligned. The importance of the subdominant multiples will be stronger the less you are circular, as I was saying, so that the more you are the faster you are plunging. And in fact, in this case, spin aligned with the angular momentum, you keep in spiraling, you keep being very symmetric, very circular, and the subdominant multiples are almost negligible. On the contrary, when you are in the other situation, these things are much more excited, and so let's say it is more complicated. Yes, this is also interesting to know, because the models that are implemented now, for spin, they only deal with the tutu mode. So this is telling you that if for some reason you have there is a binary where the spins are like this, I mean, I don't know if this exists, but let's suppose this might be the situation, you might get bias in your determination of the parameters, because the contribution of the subdominant multiple, the 2, 1, the 3, is relevant in that case. So modulo signal-to-noise ratio and all that, you might have systematic uncertainties due to something that is not moderate. What I want to stress is that there are no, at least in my framework, there are no conceptual problems in completing with all multiples, because actually, yeah, what I want to stress is that the ubicode that I mentioned that is public is just the non-spinning one, and it has the 2-2, the 2-1, and the 3-3 mode complete with merger and ring down. When you have spin, it was not done. I mean, the multiples are actually there, but the merger and ring down is not perfect. But this was not done, and not because there are conceptual problems there. It's just that lack of time. So it's among the things that have to be done. It's I plan to do this in the next future, because it works for each multiple. It works the same way. You can add an effective factor to deal with the next to quasi-circular correction, and then you will have a description of the ring. But okay, all this discussion for the multipolar structure of the waveform, because when you have a processing system, due to the fact that this thing is moving, it has two things. It starts oscillating, and then the higher multiples might be stronger than for the spin-aligned thing. And it is a gauge effect, in a sense. I mean, you see these things, and you can see also coupling between the things due to the motion of the orbital plane. Okay. Now, what I wanted to say here is that the analysis was done using this other SUBNRV2 model. As I was saying, SUBNRV3, this exists. It is a processing model, and it is the state of the art. And processing means what? That you have an Hamiltonian. In this Hamiltonian, you keep all the angles with the spin. So you have the evolution, the usual evolution of the canonical variable for the orbits, but you have also the evolution of the spins, because also the spin evolve. There are some effects that also are relevant but are not included in the models, at least not completely, which are, for example, horizon absorption. The black holes can also absorb gravitational waves, and this may eventually influence your in spiral. This effect is stronger when the black holes are highly spinning. But, okay, currently it is not there. It is an effect that enters at high post-Newtonian order. There are post-Newtonian calculations for this. They are non-resummed properly, so there is some work that needs to be done there if you want to have a complete thing, at least to put all the pieces of physics that exist, that maybe is completely irrelevant, but I mean, you have to work and possibly publish something from time to time in order to make your career proceed. And then finally, what I want to say is that this is also SUBNRV4, which is the state of the art UBNR model in the LIGO data analysis library, which is called LIGO LAL. What is it? LIGO analysis library. It should be this. And what is this? So this is an object that has a different Hamiltonian with respect to what I was discussing now, that is a little bit more involved, I think, but anyway, it doesn't matter. And they have a spin orbit and spin parameter that have to tune to match with numerical relativity simulation. And eventually, that appeared just in paper 1 month ago, they get this kind of unfaithfulness all over the 141, maybe there are also 150 actually, in our simulations with that exist in here, in the that were produced by the Caltech-Cornell collaboration. That in fact, okay, there is this collaboration where they have the sort of the best code available that allows you to compute in numerical relativity very long waveforms. As I said, it is not really useful now to have such a long waveforms, or let's say, I think there is enough information for what we need, or let's say not longer than something. I mean, it's not enough, it's not needed to do 70 orbits. When you have 30 orbits, you see that the analytical model and the numerical relativity, they are, the difference is just flat, so it is more than enough to do what you want to do. And anyway, there are about 150 simulations that now are public, and this model was tuned and checked on all this. And this is what will be used, and it proved to be better than what exists here, although it is still to see whether, this is what I was mentioning before, our alternative proposal is at the same level or can be better like this here, but this is irrelevant from the data analysis point of view, it's just for my happiness that. And this is what will be used and applied on the next runs that are actually currently going, so that they were able to complete this model, I mean, just in time for the beginning of the new science run of LIGO. Yes, so the spin, the precession, yes. And in fact, what I did not mention is, yes, how does a precessing waveform look like? A precessing waveform look like this. So that, I don't know what is this, is it 0505? So they are aligned, I don't know, they should be misaligned in some form, and maybe it is even written there. And you see that there are modulations on the waveform due to the motion of the orbital plane. And in fact, how it is done, it is basically, here there was no additional tuning done. So the model here was a model, the SUBNRV2 model, that was calibrated to numerical relativity for a spin aligned case. Then they say, okay, I have this parameter. I just take the general Hamiltonian with the general dependence on the spin, and I let the code run, and this is what it gives. And, look into this plot, it shows a good agreement, are almost indistinguishable, modulo something around the merge and all that, between the UB and the numerical waveform. But this is not the only thing that exists. In fact, there is another proposal that is related to this this phenomenological waveform, so that, let's say, phenomenological or whatever waveform. Actually, what you can do is take into account the spin precession at leading order only, and do what is called a sort of twist on the waveform, which, okay, this is, I don't know this well, but let's say I give you the idea, because it is basically just a change of frame. So let's suppose that you are in the non-precessing frame. If you are in the non-precessing frame, you can have the waveform as the usual shape. Then you know how this frame moves, because you know how the spins are there, and you have a sort of description of the dynamics that tells you how these things, how the orbital plane moves. And then what you can do is say, okay, I have the waveform here that is non-precessing. I am in a different reference system, and I just change coordinates from the processing system to the non-processing thing. And if you do that, you will see that if you have the waveform that is flat like that, the modulus, you will get the modulations due to the precession. So that it seems, at least up to spin 0.5, that the leading orders, the effect of the leading order precession is enough, because in fact they used a different model that is much less sophisticated than the UB1, with really much less physics inside, but with this idea of twisting a waveform, changing from one system, one reference system to the other. I think that things work well just because for the moment the signal-to-noise ratio are small, and but anyway, it is an idea that could be exploited more in the future. Yeah, indeed. And what is the point of changing the waveform from one system to the other? Okay, we said that H plus minus H cross is this YLM theta phi, but let's say this is a theta phi. This is a reference system that is put here. Let's put it in this way. You want to see it from elsewhere, so you will have to change this thing, and then you will get something to modify the HLM. Evidently, if you thought this is a tensor, the HAJ is a tensor, I know I have to transform the tensor in a certain way. Here I will have to use the representation of the transformation on the multiples, and there are formulas with all the Clebsch-Gordan coefficients and all this stuff. Those kind of things that you saw maybe once in your life when you were a student, and then you would have not would have liked not to see again in your life, but eventually eventually this is life is tough. Anyway, now I would consider myself done for what concerns black holes, because this I don't want to mention, and instead I will spend the last hour, if you are still here. What hour? I saw somebody say 1 hour. What are you saying? You are crazy. Hour? No, indeed. Where I'm supposed to finish? At 11:30, right? Really? Oh, okay. Oh, if you wish, okay. 15. Hour. Okay, I wanted to tell you a lot of things about binary black holes. Anyway, binary black holes, this is what was detected. We have not detected neutron stars yet, maybe. So, it could be a good idea anyway to sketch at least what you can do for neutron stars, which is much simpler, luckily. I mean, from the analytical point of view, it's simpler. Is simpler, it's, and it works also rather well. From the numerical point of view, it's much complicated stuff, because you have to evolve also the hydro equations, and this is complicated. But in fact, what do you want to do? Okay, let me summarize in 20 minutes. 25. We'll see. Okay, so you have two neutron stars. Very good. Two neutron stars means that originally, maybe if they are very far away, let's say they are spherical, come si dice, Giotto mi fa un baffo, this you will have to translate. Okay, let's say they are should be very far away. D is very large, okay, and they are spherical if they are not rotating or if the rotation is small. Then they get close, they start feeling the gravitational field from the others, and then they deform, they get what we can call the tidal. Yes, this is, I'm so good at doing circles that I'm unable to do ellipses. Okay, you get they get deformed, and they get tidally polarized. So what happens is that, in fact, that the gravitational field of this thing is different from the gravitational field of this thing, because you get multiples. It means derivatives of 1 over r squared. Mm. And in fact, if you think, and if you are in Newtonian theory, you know that in Newtonian theory, a point particle has a potential that is like that. But if you do Newtonian theory with an extended object, you get another term in potential, and you get something like that. You can get a last stable orbit, and this is maybe the reason why, if you have an object, eventually can fall on the other. It is always the same kind of thing. Because what this will do is add an attractive term that to the thing. So, but then we said deformation, or let's say better say, the stars will acquire a quadruple moment, or in general multiple moments. I mean, we'll talk about that. And the star will deform. What is inside? I mean, it will deform more, it will deform less, it will depend on the equation of state. In particular, if you have an equation of state, this will get a certain higher quadrupole moment. You have another equation of state among those that nuclear physicists can provide us with. You will get a different quadrupole moment. So that if you are able to measure the tidal deformation, or let's say the amount of tidal interaction between the two neutron stars when they in spiral plunge, you could put a constraint on the nuclear equation of state. So you could do nuclear physics using gravitational waves. Okay? So to do this, you need a description of these objects. Again, an analytical description, if you wish. So for the same reasons that we discussed before. So even more for neutron stars, because for the simulation with matter are much worse from the computational point of view than those for black holes, because you have also to solve the matter equation. The computational cost is larger. You cannot do, still nowadays, you cannot do extremely long waveforms. And okay, that's why already from, we said from 2001, one started developing the, from 2001, 2011, one started developing the tidal part of the effective one body approach. That is very well, very strongly attached to what you do in Newtonian theory. And in particular, you have this. Okay? This means what? You know, you are perfectly used now to the multi-index notation, so that this is the external multipolar field in general, so the field, that the gravitational field that is generated by this. And how was that? This I don't remember. In Newtonian theory, if you have the phi, yes, the quadrupolar field means, okay, let's put it in this way, see if I remember correctly. We are in Newtonian theory, so let's say this is this generates a certain gravitational field. It is a phi that will be 1 over r, I mean m over r. And then the quadrupole will just be two derivatives of 1 over r. Okay? This will give you a quadrupole moment that in additionally to this. Okay? So this will have something, and this will induce a deformation. I mean, the point gravitational field here will deform this thing, and this thing will, once it is deformed, will get an additional term to its gravitational field. But the problem is to determine the polarization constant. Okay? So, external multipolar field induced multiple moments, so the object gets another multiple that is proportional to something. Once that you write it dimensionless, is this k. Yes, I did not do the reproduction. That is this, and that is called the Love numbers. love numbers. Love numbers that, in fact, love numbers because they were first studied by a guy whose name is Love at the beginning of the 20th century in studying the, I think, the motion of the moon. And in fact, here we are talking of a situation where you have the two objects that are just like this. There is a lot of theory on this because you can have the formation, the things can rotate and all that. And so what you need is a relativistic generalization of these things in general relativity. And then the question is, who is the one that introduced for the first time the notion of law of numbers in general relativity? Savasandir, Thibaut d'Amour in 1983. And in fact, he talked about this in 1983, and maybe Christodoulou asked him, but you call them love numbers because of you, because d'Amour means of love. And I said, no, it's not of me. it's somebody else, and that's a good thing. And yeah, I think it was Christodoulou. But in fact, in 1983, in the, I think it is in the Lesouche lectures, this is introduced, but it is not calculated. It was a bit lazy. Because you need any way to, you need to solve an equation numerically. So that's maybe the point. And these objects in Newtonian theory are of order unity when you are here. So at the time, unity, I mean 0.3 for a standard polytropic equation of state with index 4/3 or whatever. So at the time, there was basically all the theory discussed in these lectures and said, okay, there is this love number that will be of order unity. But in fact, it is introduced there for a very important reason, because in those lectures, it is said in a usual way, in a very, let's say, very synthetic way where you can find everything. It is about the fact that you can use delta functions to represent black holes to do calculation up to 5 PN, because this thing enters at 5 PN. And that's the reason why you can do post-Newtonian calculation at very high order, neglecting completely the structure of the objects. Yes, then this notation actually was introduced and used in the already, yes, no, this is interesting. In all the series of paper about general relativistic post-Newtonian mechanics, post-Newtonian, yes, 1 PN mechanics, of N, not general relativistic, it's post-Newtonian, N-body post-Newtonian mechanics, and it is a series of paper, D'Amour DSX. D'Amour Sofelk Su from, should be 1989, 1991, something like that, where they study the 1 PN equation of motions in detail. And the idea is to say, okay, I want to do post-Newtonian mechanics. I mean, n-body motion, the motion of n-body system in the solar system, okay? To include the relativistic correction in the solar system. And this is done in this series of paper. There are five of these things. And there is first this notation appearing in one of the an appendix, I mean, 20 lines that you have to look for this. Where in fact, this is the mu L, it remembers the electric, how is this? It is a, it's like an electric polarization coefficient, no? It's just that, so there are the electric ones, and these are the odd ones, like for the magnetic ones. Okay, this just to say that there are these things, and then you can compute these things in general relativity. Computation in general relativity for the first time was done in 2007 by Tanya Inderer. In fact, in 2007-2008, there are two papers. This is for Tanya Inderer, and then by Inderer and Flanagan. Inderer was the PhD student of Flanagan. So in 2007, she computed for the first time the Love numbers, getting things of order, let's say, 0.34 standard polytropic equation of state that you can use to represent a Newton star. And immediately, they used this thing in 2008. They wrote a PRL. Where they were including this thing in the usual post-Newtonian description of the spiral and said, ah, this is very strong, it can be measured by LIGO. Unfortunately, using the spiral, unfortunately, there was a calculational error here. So that the results, this was incorrect, and also the claims that were here were incorrect. I mean, the idea was correct. The idea that you want to extract information about the equation of state using the law of numbers. Ah, yes, because what maybe is here. So what I want to stress is that when you compute the law of numbers, this depends on the equation of state. I'm not sure that I have another equation of state, no. But, I mean, you change equation of state, for example, realistic equation of states, these are functions of the compactness, and changing the equation of state, you can have different things. So that if you measure this number, you are able to go back to the equation of state. So the idea was absolutely correct, but there was this calculation and error. So that was absolutely unnoticed until 2009. There was the group, Thibault and myself, and Eric Poisson and his student, whose name is Binnington, I don't remember the name. Anyway, at the beginning of 2009, we said, okay, it was the time where more or less we were arrived at a moment where the effective one body was working for the non-spinning case. We wrote a paper and said, okay, maybe this is fine for the moment. And we start saying, okay, let's see what happens for binary neutron star, because at the same time, the neutron star the simulation of binary neutron star were starting becoming mature, let's say. So it was a good idea to have a look at those things. So I looked at the literature and I found this paper, and Thibault, who said, ah, yes, great, this is, let me see what it's doing. Ah, perfect, it is doing what I did. I wanted to do in 1983, but I did not know how to solve the equation. I mean, he didn't say that, but let's say maybe he was busy with other stuff. But then when I started looking at things, there was something that was clearly wrong. So we redid the thing, but in this case it was just the L equal to case. We wanted to exaggerate, and we did the general theory of this thing. But in a sense, it was easy, at least for one of the two co-authors, because it was to use most of the information that was in the DSX series paper, and the real complication was to write an equation and solving it and doing a few other things. At the same time, also Binnington and Poisson had noticed the same thing. So we were doing the same calculation, although in different ways, because they were using a different gauge. And in fact, we published at 1 week difference, one from the other. I mean, we didn't know. Just at the moment, we heard that there was something. Okay, let's rush. But the good thing was that everything was consistent, and now this has become routinary, so that you have the love numbers, and then there is the next step. What do you do with these love numbers? Okay, these are the polarization constant. I need to introduce them in the effective one-body approach. And again, this is our choice. And already at the time, it was 2011, the idea was just to do what you can do in Newtonian theory. So you just add a tidal term to the usual I0 thing, And this tidal term is u to the 6, so is a 5n connection with a coefficient here that is a combination of the two, of the love numbers of the two stars, the compactnesses, and the M1 MIB divided by 2. Note that here there is a fifth order, a fifth power for L equal 2. L equal 2, which means what? That even if, I know, yes, the important thing is this, that, I mean, this is small. This is relatively small. This is, for equal mass, is 0.5, but this is 1/4 of this. You have the fifth power. Altogether, this thing can be of order 100, which indicates that even if this is a 5pn effect, it can, so in principle it should be a small thing for binary black hole, it has a huge coefficient, so it can do really something. And this something is, I mean, there are a lot of technical details that I don't want to enter in, but this something is this. So that, for example, okay, this is a bad plot, but let me discuss it on the blackboard, okay? It has a minus sign, so it is always attractive. So that for a black hole, you have something like this. You have the merger and delta. And then a neutron star, took because it is attractive, will plunge here at lower frequencies. And then there will be, evidently, you won't have a ring down. You will have a post-merger phase and so on and so forth. And this was known in 2000. When was it? 2011, when we were proposing the TEOB, the tidal EOB model. You can also write this as Theobald, but this is this is for fun. So this is 2011, but the problem was: is the amount of tidal interaction that we are there that is predicted by the EOB approach correct or not? So on the one hand, one was doing higher post-Newtonian calculation, and this actually there was my first daughter that was born. So I was not at the IHS at the time, but luckily Donato Bini was visiting at the same time. So they started doing post-Newtonian calculation in order to go to higher PN. And since Donato is a great analytical guy, they could do the 2PN calculation, I mean, the higher tides, and then they did more. I mean, so that now there is more analytical information that is telling you that the tidal interaction becomes even stronger than the leading order thing. Okay? And a couple of years ago, we said, okay, we want to compare, okay, already at the time, comparing this with numerical simulation. The first comparison was clear that there was the tidal interaction from numerical relativity was very strong. But at the time, what was unclear was whether this was real or it was numerical noise. The computation of errors was a bit, let's say, end wavy. Then, I think we are already in 2013 or 2014, the crucial person that entered in this game and then brought it to the level of maturity where we are now, I think, is Sebastiano Bernuzzi, that is now in Parma. And that restart, I mean, numerical simulation of BNS existed from very long time. So, from my youth, yes, 3 minutes and then I'm done. There was, I mean, everybody knew that. But numerical errors was large. So as soon as he started doing that, we were starting doing very careful analysis of the errors with the precise idea of figuring out whether what you see is real or fake. So the conclusion was that there were large errors, these errors were reduced. Even without this, there is an amplification of numerical of the tidal with respect to this, and this work that is 2014 were showing the state of the art at the time with the best simulation for different equation of state. Different equation of state, you just mean that you change the tidal interaction parameter, and you had a model that is rather good up to merger, modulo the errors. Now we have better simulation, and this analysis, it will be improved in the next 3 days, because I'm going to Valencia to give a talk, and I will have a new waveform from this and new comparisons. But let's say, I can say that at the moment this is good enough and hopefully will be used in the future detection. And I stop so that everybody is happy, and even if I am a bit integrating on some details, but it's enough. It was okay. Thank you. Probably nobody wants to make questions, so a coffee.